and where we discuss things, we come up with ideas, we think about it, like whether it would work or not. We do A/B testing sort of, and then eventually you get to see it. And if your response is good, it goes ahead and it's like it goes on to a much bigger scale. So I think I'll move on to my slides. That's a basic introduction about myself. Feel free to ask any question you want, because I haven't made any good PPT. I don't know how to make good PPTs. So this is, Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'm here to talk about strategic selling for startups. I've never sold something for startups, but yeah, I've sold ideas. So that is one thing which is a very basic thing for a product manager, because if you come up with any idea, you have to sell it to a group of people. And a group of people could be as small as like a person, like one guy who is the CEO of the company. And that is the toughest job, by the way. And the second thing is like you sell it to people who are your counterparts, like your vendors, your team, and people who care about the product as much as you. Basically, it could be anyone. So this is my basic learning about sales. So first of all, you would have learned much better than me what is sales and what is marketing. But I just wanted to know whether you guys know, what is the difference between marketing and sales? Marketing is creating awareness. That's good. Again, some more ideas? Guys, you can tell me anything. Yeah, so marketing is selling a solution. Not so much true. I would say marketing and sales is like a push and pull phenomena. So sales is a push thing. You go ahead, go on a one-on-one chat with someone, and you push your product. You tell about your product, you tell about beauties of your product, stuff like that. And marketing is a pull. When you sell something, you push it, and when you market something, you kind of create a pull towards your own product. So I would create a brand of, let's say, Crackle, and you would go there and buy it just because I've told Karina to buy it in such a way that you guys, you know, feel that thing, you want to eat it. And this is something which every, you know, chocolate ads are made out of. Look, this is a brand, this is a classic brand strategy. They want you to eat it the way they want to eat, and like, it's like maza aa gaya bhai. So this is something which is marketing. And sales is something where you go and you tell about your product. Like, it's really good thing. It's like a best chocolate that I've made. It's a homemade chocolate. Would you like to try it? I'll give you one thing to eat. And then if you like it, then you'll buy something. This is a classic sales. Here we are going to talk about sales, not as much as marketing and branding and stuff like that. So in sales, when you want to pitch it, when you want to pitch your product to someone, you have to first, you know, generate a lead. How would you sell it to someone once you, you know, when you don't even know whom you are selling? So lead generation becomes one of the most, I would say, pain in the ass. And this is something where a lot of technology comes into picture. And that is where me as a product manager can talk about sales, because I have not done sales in my life, but I still know about sales because I do the lead generation part. So how do you generate lead? Let's assume you have something in your hand. How do you generate lead? We'll come to cold calling. So everybody understands what's a cold call? A cold call is when you talk to 50 random people on street. You don't even know them, they don't even know you, but somehow you think, cold calling, yeah. Cold calling is like when you roam around the streets, you want to sell something, you don't know who the person is, and the person doesn't know you. So you're kind of just, you know, doing like, hawa mein patthar maar rahe ho, देख रहे हो कि कौन पीछे मुड़ के देखता है. दिस इज लाइक अ बेसिक डेफिनेशन ऑफ कोल्ड कॉलिंग. एंड आई डोंट थिंक इट्स ओनली डिजायरेबल व्हेन यू आर डेस्परेट टू यू नो गेट समथिंग. अदरवाइज कोल्ड कॉलिंग इज द वर्स्ट आइडिया दैट यू कैन इमेजिन. एंड आई वुड सजेस्ट टू डू समथिंग मोर इनोवेटिव दैन दैट. So we'll come to cold calling, but yeah. Any other ideas? How do you generate leads?
Through references in family.
Through networking, yeah. So through references in family, that's the best idea that you can have. If you have references in family, nothing beats that. Any other thing?
Visiting some kind of exhibitions.
Through surveys, that's another good point, yeah.
Visiting to some kind of exhibitions and you know making your good network with other people and corporates.
Yeah, so networking basically. So networking helps you first of all find out what so first of all find out who your population is. So when you are doing something like a branding exercise or going and creating a booth somewhere in a sports festival or something like that, you know who your audience would be. So you have kind of narrowed down your population to a population where you would understand something about them. You won't understand everything, but yeah, you would have narrowed it down. Then surveys. So he talked about surveys. So surveys is another very good measure to find out who is interested in you. If you sell, if you want to send surveys to 50 people, let's say 10 respond. The 10 people who have responded have given you their stamp of approval. They understand what you're selling and they've come back with something. This is one very good measure. Any other thing? Market research and survey, I think, how would you do market research? Have you heard of, webinars and seminars, this is again networking, yeah. How would you create demand for the product, dude? Huh? Advertisement. So that's something which comes under marketing and we are not covering that. So advertising is something which requires a lot of money, a lot of other things which like it's not in the scope of this talk. Word of mouth publicity. How do you do that?
Doing the BTL activities, below the line, activations and promotions.
Activations and promotions, I would say if you can just, say one thing which really matters here is if you can really connect with people who are your target audience.
Yeah.
So whether through surveys, whether through word of mouth, whether through doing some branding or promotion activities, doing advertising for them, stuff which you can do for a very specific target audience. Let's assume you want to sell your own version of popcorns in your campus. You want to set up a stall. You know what kind of audience comes to your campus, and eventually you can, target them through some sort of advertisement, through some sort of a catchy line, a catchy poster, stuff like that. So this done on a larger scale, this can be done on a larger scale. This is usually done on a larger scale through use of media and the mediums of publicity. And this is one of the most important mediums to generate those leads. And still in India, it's like ever evolving. And with use of technology, this becomes very easy. You can generate forms. You can generate a lot of things through one click of a button, which happens on Facebook, which happens on Instagram, which happens like on your usual social media. So this becomes the critical part. Once you have generated your leads, now your sales cycle starts. Now you know what to do and what not to do. So, we were stuck in some place till here where we were not knowing whether we would be able to sell something or not. Now we have got some leads. Now, once you have got those leads, how do you want to target them? How do you want to connect with them? So the basic general idea would be to go personally, meet them, sell them you would have a pitch. You would have something ready with yourself. You would go to them, you would talk to them, and you would try to sell them through some communication. Usually that doesn't happen. Like, on a first meeting, on a first conversation, you won't be able to sell me even as, like, very basic stuff. I won't have that kind of connection with you, that level of confidence, that level of trust. would not be there. So it requires a certain effort. Yeah, it requires a certain effort and time. So we'll go deep into that. So understanding a sales cycle and defining what are our core objectives and goals is something which is the crux of any sales and any business, like any area where you want to get money out of someone. Because getting money out of someone is the job. That is the main idea. Doing anything, if people don't give you money, like it's, I think, as worthless as doing nothing. Like you would just sit and chill. Why do stuff when people don't want to pay money to you? So that's the crux of the things. Now, to understand the cycle, where to understand the psychology behind a person when he's making a purchase. So let's take yourself, like each one of you, you're a purchaser. You purchase stuff. You spend your money. How do you do that? Do you do it in a impulse binge purchase? And even if you do that, like how many times would you do that? It's very rare, and we'll exclude that. So how do you purchase something? Let's take a very simple case. Just like a few weeks ago, there was a big billion sale. How many of you participated in that? Big billion sale. You did? Only one, two. What is happening here, guys? So none of you put like it's a shocking thing. Okay, I'll accept this. Moving on. So the point I was trying to raise was that in Big Billion, it was the idea of a Big Billion or a random fiery sale or a flash sale is that they want you to, you know, just do a binge purchase. They don't want you to think a lot. And when you think a lot, you tend to slip out. You tend to drop. And the dropping happens because they haven't done their effort of, you know, understanding that circle, that cycle, which goes through every purchase. So if they want to avoid understanding that sales cycle, if they want to avoid that time period, that is when they come up with things like Big Billion and stuff like that. So most of you come under the people who would always want those people to spend their time, understand you guys, and then sell it to you. So you are like the hard guys. You're like, abhi aise nahi bikunga main. Mujhe lagao time, mehnat karo, then I'll buy something. Or else, it's a tough job with those marketing efforts that they've put in and you not even buy, like only two people bought stuff. Like, they must have spent crores worth of marketing, budgets. But anyways, huh? So to build a successful sales cycle, one has to understand that not every lead that comes through is a hot one. Like it's not the one who would get their credit cards out, get their cash out and like just start purchasing. You would need to spend the time with them. You would need to tell them about your product. You would need to understand what they require. Not everyone has a specific requirement with them. Not every person who purchases stuff has a clear agenda. You don't have a clear agenda every time you go on and you are approached by someone with a lead. So to understand that, you need to spend some time. And it requires, on an average, 7 to 8 meetings or interactions or whatever you call them to sell something. It's a general trend. We have seen that a lot of people who come to Dream 11, they initially, so Dream 11 is a gaming platform. I would not use that as an example in future, but just this last time. So a lot of people come, then they play for free, then eventually they try to win, and if they see that, okay, something is happening, they can win their money back, stuff like that. So by the 7th or 8th time, they would put in their real money and they would start playing. So this is something which is a benchmark. I've seen this across companies and across people who do sales activities that it requires around 7 to 8 interactions with a consumer once they go and they actually put in their money. So it's something with to do with a sales cycle. A sales cycle is something where you categorize your leads in hot, cold, and somewhat in the middle. And cold calling, yeah, you talked about cold calling. So cold calling is something where you would have those leads, you would just go on, you know, bothering them about your product. Like this is, Airtel se call aaya hai, bhai hamare paas nayi sim hai, jo ki tumhe itna itna fayda degi, wagera wagera. How many of you, like even listen to them? No, that is exact definition of a cold calling. That's so bad that you even get frustrated and that damages your brand. So we'll come to that, why it's a bad idea to do cold calling. Now, understanding sales. So as a product guy, I would always say that it's nothing to do with the way you dress up. It's nothing to do with the way you handle a relationship with a person. It's always to do with what you are selling. It's always what is the product that you're selling. If your product is good, it would sell itself. If your product is not good, you would need a person who would just, you know, go on connivingly addressing the person and understanding what to say to him that pleases him the most, or stuff like that. That never works with startups because startups don't have that amount of money to buy, to hire those type of salespeople. So it's almost always exclusively about the quality of your product. So I would say the psychology of confidence in your product, the stuff like when you, so this is an example that I came up with like instantly. How do you approach a girl when you want to, you know, let's assume you want to get on and just approach a girl. What happens, what is the thing that can pull you to say the stuff that you want to say? It would never be the lies, it would never be the conniving stuff, it would never be the thing that salespeople, whatever thing that we have in our minds. It's always about the inner quality that you have. That is the best thing that you can go up to her and say to her that she would actually get convinced. This is just a male analogy, I understand. But yeah, it applies both ways. So it is something which, you know, is the inherent quality about a person that sells the best. So it's always what you believe in. It's always, if you believe in your product, if I believe in my product, it would sell itself. If I believe in myself, that girl would never reject me. Or whenever I go to her, I would go with that confidence, even to address, whenever the problem arises, I would try to address things in a very, you know, calm and composed way, because I'm confident about my product, I'm confident about myself. So the stuff goes, the stuff works. So this is some basic quality about sales that I always think that it works, kind of. Never think of it as a negotiation. Yeah, that is one thing. It's one of my beliefs. How many of you believe that if you think of a sales activity, or if you think of starting something, and you go ahead and try to approach a person that, ki mera product hai, would you buy it? Would you approach that discussion as a negotiation versus something that comes out of your heart? Yeah, so that's something which I think everybody believes in. So that's the point that I wanted to address. Now coming to the current state of affairs. I was told by ma'am to talk about a lot of issues, like a lot of topics. And I could only address one topic, which is selling in startups. And the rest of the topics I would very kindly ignore. So I would want to talk about Indian startups and the startups, the startup scene that happens in India. It's a very, very common case of usual businesses, like dukaan chalana hai bhai. Dukaan chalana hai hame, but we'll use the technology really, really well. We know, we understand technology, we know how to use it, and we'll use it really well. We'll challenge the like the conventional businesses with a model wherein we would do the same thing that they do. Like Amazon is a dukaan, it's a kirane ki dukan, it's an electronics ki dukan, it's a kapdo ki dukan. But they're doing that with the use of technology. And with technology comes a lot of, you know, tumhare haath Durga ji ke nau haath ban jate hain aur fir tumhare paas bahut sari cheeze hoti hai karne ke liye aur jo sari cheeze kar pate ho tum wo basically that is defined through the reach that you can you can approach problems, you can address issues like customer complaints. So I'll take a very simple example. Customer complaints in a usual kirane ki dukan, it would always be through giving good services initially so that you don't have any customer complaints. But if you have a customer complaint, I cannot do anything about it. Please don't buy from me. Like, if you don't want to buy from me, then it's okay. But here they have another concept of customer complaints. They will refund you stuff, they'll give you cashbacks, they'll do a lot of stuff to you to please you, which only happens through a technology platform that they've built. And they can understand, okay, this is our premium, this is a prime customer. If you understand what a prime customer is, the kind of customers who pay to get their services early, to, you know, buy more, and to even address a lot of issues like, I'm a prime customer, I want things in like one day, so I'll have a better queue, like a shorter queue than a usual customer. So if I want stuff in one day, I have to be a prime customer who pays for stuff, and then I'll get it in one day. If I'm not a prime customer, I won't get it in one day. So these are kind of things which only happen through technology, and technology gives you the right, probably I would say the right, to charge money for better services, because they can do better services. And this is something which Indian startups are really, really, you know, doing really good. Have you seen Uber versus Ola discussions on social media? What do you think is the difference between Uber and Ola? Yeah, Uber is global, Ola is only India. That's a very given fact. I was talking more about the kind of services that they give to you. Have you tried complaining on Uber? What's the medium that they allow you to file your complaints? Only email. Only email. And that is something which is there throughout. Like, it's not just in India. Uber primarily deals with customer complaints only through emails. So that's the Western concept. Ola came up with a lot of things, and eventually Ola also was bombarded with a lot of customer callings and stuff like that. So they have also reduced it a bit now, but they were still keen on having a customer complaint which is through a lot of other things than email. So this is something which I think Indian companies do quite well, and it is something to do with using technology innovatively. They do normal stuff. Ola doesn't do anything which Uber doesn't do, but they do much more than what Uber does. They have much more base than Uber has. So that is something to do with using technology effectively. Why are VCs investing in Ola rather than Uber in India? The brand has to be there. Without brand, nobody would invest in you, yeah, obviously. But what is the edge case? What is the edge case? Like, if both of you are comparable and I want to hire only one of you, why would I hire an Ola versus an Uber? A Flipkart versus an Amazon? Let's assume a Paytm versus a PayPal? I would agree to that. So he says that Ola has more services than Uber. I would say not necessarily. Both of them have almost the same kind of services. Okay, so that has again all the things to do with sales. You know how a usual conversation that happens in a VC meeting. So there would be Ola sitting there with their own PPTs, with their own charts, with their own, you know, projections and stuff like that. They would have a certain image that is portrayed in front of all VC community when they would say that, okay, Ola is something which is growing faster than Uber. And Ola is someone who is approaching their targets much better in a smooth manner and stuff like that. So they would try to sell their achievements, which are not so great, and tell them that, okay, this is something which is going to go, matlab chappar faad ke bhi profits kamane wale hum log next year bilkul, or come and invest in us. This is something which is sales basically. And the primary reason why these guys have got a lot of funding is because they are excellent salespeople. Bhavish Mittal, this Bhavish Agarwal, and the both Mittals in Flipkart, they are considered to be the best salesmen in the industry. They could get a lot of funding from a lot of players who would not have understood Indian market, who would not have come to India and invested. These are the people who know how they could project the image that India had in countries like Japan, where essentially a consumer is much different from India. They don't actually value the kind of chaos that we see in India on a day-to-day basis, but still they're investing heavily in India in services like Paytm, in services like Ola, in services like Flipkart. They're excellent salespersons who understand what is the requirement by the guy who has a lot of money, and how do I take his money? It's always about sales. And this is something which every startup guy follows: which company got funded, how did they get funded, and essentially it always comes back to salesmanship and how do you project your image, how do you create your brand, how do you approach your customers, and how do you service them eventually. This is something which is very inherent to any basic business that you can see. We are going to go a little deeper into that through case studies. Now, I've taken some very different companies, and so these are four of my friends who I had a chat with yesterday. And one of my friend, he works for Topper. Have you guys heard of Topper? Have you ever used their services? Okay, so Topper, so I would like, if you want to, just try downloading their Android app on your phone and try going through the onboarding process. You would get to know a lot more in detail what I'm talking about. You can do it just right now, because it's an exercise which if you don't do, you would not understand what I'm saying. So just go ahead and try downloading their app on your phone. If you want to, it's not a compulsion. So this is an app which lets you use the materials that are available for IIT JEE preparation for a cost. They would also let you use their test which happen on a regular basis for a given cost. And everything is sold only online and through calling. So once you do their onboarding, they would ask you for their for your phone numbers. And when you have an onboarding where they ask you for your phone number, a lot of people give fake phone numbers. That's what we have seen. So then the purpose is defied, because I want you to sell stuff. I want to sell you stuff, but you give me a wrong phone number and I can't sell you stuff now. So I would ask you for your OTP. So a one-time password actually makes sure that you're giving your correct phone number and then only you're getting in. And the reason for that is, just after you do the onboarding, in a day or two, you would receive a call from them explaining to you about what is the basic service that they provide and what is the cost associated with it. And eventually they would want you to buy it. Yeah. So this is the basic way that they sell stuff. The other one, TV is again one of the startups started by my friends. Yeah, Bangalore-based startup. They sell something like a Chromecast. A Chromecast is something which is like a USB device. It goes onto your TV and it makes it smart. It connects it to your internet, and it has an app which you can download. Yeah. So how do they sell it? How you know about TV? How did you come to know about TV? Now, did you Google TV? Because for that, you have to know TV before that. Okay, through friends. Anyone else? Okay. Huh. So this is somewhere they use technology. You search Chromecast, they would give you suggestions, stuff like that. Okay, so they would pay for that service. So Google actually gives you a service wherein through Google, you can cross promote your stuff and you have to pay Google for every kind of impression and stuff like that. So this is the way which they promote their product. And one more way that they did promote is through Snapdeal fire sale or whatever sale they call it, Big Billion Day or whatever. So they had a tie-up with Snapdeal wherein on the day of Big Billion Day, when all the Chromecast would be sold out and all those products which are so much in demand, they would not be available, this product would come in at a much discounted price. And this is how they wanted to do their marketing as well as sales. So marketing and sales is something which, if you have a program which connects both these, marketing as well as sales, together, that has a very good impact as compared to only sales activity or only marketing activity. And this is something which these guys did really, really well. Their product is now sold, the TV got sold off, and this USB device is something which is still going on. Like, people are still searching it, people are still buying it, and it's something which is happening without the intervention of a salesperson. So there's no need of a salesperson for a device which is physically sold. And this is a very interesting example, and we actually studied this example quite a lot in detail. If you have any questions or a doubt regarding this, you can ask me straightforwardly right now, because after that, you'll also forget. Because this is something which is a product which you would buy. This is not something which is an online service like TV. Topper. Topper is an online service. It's a service which is given to you for exchange of money. And the service can be used very temporarily wherever you want to do it. But TV is a physical device. It's like a smartphone. It's like a device. And selling that device without the use of any physical infrastructure, like a store where you would buy TV, like a conventional medium of sales, there's no such thing for TV. And it's still selling just because they use marketing and sales in a mixture. Wherever they find any opportunity, they would crack a deal with these guys and they will just start selling TV over there. Like he said, so he came up, or you go on Flipkart on a Big Billion Day where you, yeah, like 2-3 ways, yeah, that's it. Because that is something which is a clear strategy decision done because they don't want to spend a lot on sales, because sales has a cost associated with it, which in turn actually gets added to your product. They want to sell this product very cheap, because otherwise you would obviously buy Chromecast. Why wouldn't you? You want to buy TV only when you want to buy cheap. And buying cheap has to have, no costs like marketing, no cost like sales, no cost like design, no cost like creating a big brand strategy or a brand promotion activity. They did no such thing. They have no brand presence whatsoever, and still people are searching it and buying it, and it's happening in a cycle. They don't have any distributor. They have local vendors in metro cities, because that's the place where stuff like Chromecast gets sold. So only in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Kolkata, only bigger cities, and only through specific channels. That's it. And they don't sell in large volumes. They sell only in small volumes, but they have their profit margins associated with each unit that gets sold. So that's how they earn their money. So that is the kind of business that they want to operate. So it's always with respect to the business that you want to operate. You don't, if you want to scale it up to a very large scale, then you do stuff like you have a huge sales team which goes door to door and sells you Eureka water purifier. So it's a very huge company which has very large scale sales team which goes door to door and sells you your water purifier, right? And that gets added to the cost of that dabba that gets sold to you, and that dabba is now worth more than that TV. So a water purifier now costs you much more than that electronic device, which is like less than 2,000 rupees. The third example is, guys, please ask questions because I'll be rushing in if you don't ask questions. Smart Medics is the third company. It's again one of my friend's company. They are trying to build a solution for doctors wherein doctors won't have to remember what their patients are doing after they once go to the doctor. So if you go to a doctor, doctor would probably give you a prescription, you would pay him, and then you would leave. And after that, you don't necessarily go to the doctor again if you don't have the same problem or if you don't feel the doctor is a good fit. But what about the doctor who has potentially lost a consumer because he has no way to reach back to him because he has no, you know, no connection with the patient. And that connection is not solved by even Practo, because Practo is just a discovery platform where you can search for a doctor. But where is that connection? Where is that, wo aajkal family doctor wala funda to khatam ho gaya. So ab how would you get a close connection with a doctor where doctor, when you go to the doctor next time, he would know, acha, last time you had this problem, okay, you were prescribed this thing, did you take it judiciously? If I referred you to a certain doctor, did you go to that doctor? So would he ask you if he, like, most of the time he wouldn't even remember. So they are trying to solve this problem where they would have a check-in every time you go to a doctor, the prescription can be saved digitally, and they can also reach back to the doctor through a chat platform where they would have some exchange. So this is a small startup right now, based out of, yeah, we'll come to that. So initially I want you guys to, as an exercise, I want to think, how would you sell it to the doctor? So if you go ahead and say that, ye log mera product, paise de dena mujhe iske, koi kyun lega? You understand the product, right? You understand what are the services that it is providing? Now, how would you go and sell it to a doctor? Or not necessarily to a doctor, what would be your sales strategy? You're again thinking about the revenue model. You're not here to, you know, get money for them. It's just a simple question of, how would you plan a sales strategy for this startup? Let's say you are interviewing with these guys and these guys ask you one simple question. Okay, define the sales strategy for a product like this. Yeah, they have a lot of money. Yeah, I'm assuming all doctors earn much more than what this thing can. Customer satisfaction, yeah. This is the crux of the product. What they're selling is the customer satisfaction. That a customer, once coming to that doctor, will be served really well. He would have all his problems sorted. If the problems are not sorted during that small interaction that they had with the doctor, eventually a patient can go back and chat with the doctor, can communicate with the doctor eventually, and also all the things would be saved periodically so that it would be a knowledge base. So that knowledge base would mean something for the consumer. Yeah, that knowledge is important because I think a lot of people don't realize the fact that your prescriptions and the treatments that you get from doctors, even they even have a value after 2 to 3 years. A lot of doctors, they ask you, what are the problems that you had in the past? What are the type of medications that you're taking and stuff like that? And this is a thing which really helps when a doctor knows, just by a flick of a thumb, he would come to know, okay, this is the problem that you had, and these are the doctors that you have seen in your past. And this is a confidential information. So if you want to disclose, only then. So this is a privacy matter, as well as customer satisfaction, as well as loyalty. So this is the thing that they're selling to doctors. And basically, they have this pamphlet which goes on to say that a patient is not worth one fee, one prescription fee that the patient sells, gives to the doctor. It's much more than that. Because in India, you would always value loyalty. You would always have references. You don't go to a doctor just because you found someone on Practo. You go to a doctor because somebody says that, ah, yeah, it's a doctor, I'm not going to be going to be somebody. So this is the way. And referencing and loyalty, like built through a tech product, is one thing which they're trying to sell. So this is something, yeah, really good, man. This is something which has to be the crux of your business when you're trying to sell to people like doctors who don't need a lot of money from you. They definitely have much more money than what you can provide. Huh. ZDV, yeah. This is an example which I specifically included. How many of you are from media or journalism background? None of you? Okay, so let me try to explain. ZTV, how does ZTV earn money? Advertising. No, it's basically purely advertising. They don't have anything which they can sell to any other person. It's just basically purely advertising. So how do they get their advertisements? And how do you think that would play eventually? Like, let's assume I'm a housewife. I just watched Sasural Simar Ka. And I think I don't want to watch any ads in between necessarily, but I'm still shown a lot of ads. And I don't think how those ads are so specific to me, but they're always very specific to me. And that is one way wherein I have actually remembered a lot of brands. So I know Nirma, I know a lot of other FMCG products, I know that Kaun Banega Crorepati kahan pe aa raha hai, I know that TV pe kabaddi kis channel pe aata hai, I know ki Saturday ko movie kaun si aane wali hai, I know a lot of things just because I watch Sasural Simar Ka. So there is something going on behind my back, right? What is that thing? Yes. Now how does that happen? So there is this thing called bark data. So let me tell you one thing, guys. Most of your TVs have been bugged. They have this device attached to your cable operator. Whenever you change a channel, it gets recorded. And the amount of time that you use, that you see that particular channel, that you visit that channel, it gets recorded. And all that data is pulled, and eventually there's a scoring for every slot that comes in. And that scoring is regional, that scoring is on a state level, it's on a national level, it's for every channel, it's for every time slot in every channel. And that is bug data. Without data, you can't know what is being viewed, how much time it is being viewed, and what is the, you know, likeliness that if a person in Borivali at 7 p.m. tonight opens this channel, like, what is going to come? Like, what is the kind of ad that is going to be shown? This is how you program these things. And then eventually, there comes a point when you know these things, and now you want to get that ad. Now, if you want to get that ad in your channel, then it becomes a sales activity. Now it has become a sales activity when you know, okay, this is the demographic population that actually views my channel at this particular time. Now, how do I get those advertisements? Because my director of Sasra Simarka needs 1 crore every year to produce this show. And I want this 1 crore rupees to be utilized. I want much more than that. And I want this channel to be like the best channel, even though I am not serving something which is of value to most of the people. But for the few people who see value in it, I want this thing to be utilized. I want this thing to be sold. Whom do I sell it to? And how do I sell it to these people? So this is kind of a thing which I'm asking a question here. I want you guys to respond. If you have this kind of information about people, what are they watching, at what time, what is the demography, like what sort of people are watching, what sort of shows, what timings. Once you know these things, how do you get the advertisements for that slot for those people? Target audience is known. Yeah. Yes. So the company would come to you like, अच्छा तो मुझे पता है कि तुम्हारे तो बहुत सारे अच्छे लोग देखते हैं ससुराल सिमर का, मेरा ऐड दे दो. ऐसा तो नहीं होगा ना. So ऐसा नहीं होगा, because companies won't necessarily know the impact of your advertisements, because they haven't tested it on your platform. So they won't know how much is their impact. So a company like, let's take a random guess, McDonald's, would not know what would be the impact of an advertisement on Kaun Banega Crorepati. So that has to be a sales activity by a salesperson from Star Plus, where that guy goes to McDonald's ka marketing ke log, and then they tell them that these are the benefits, this is the things that you get. This is like very basic one-to-one selling that is happening. And that one-to-one selling has a specific rate associated with each and every schedule. And that gets, you know, competing ads for that particular rate. So a show like Kaun Banega Crorepati would have 5 different people who would bid for a particular slot. So that slot bidding happens through a very transparent channel, where you would have to write, okay, this is the ad that I want to show, this is the cost that I'm willing to pay. And since you have already promised me, your salesperson came to me and promised me that I would get these many things in return. I would get my brand loyalty, I would get a lot of people, I would get a lot of orders online or offline or whatever. And this is the things that they have promised me. So I want this slot for this particular rate. And similarly, a lot many other people would fill in that form, and then eventually that bidding would happen, wherein real time you would see, okay, jisne sabse zyada paisa mark kiya hai na, uska main ad dikha deta hu wahan par. Something like a stock market trade, where a trade happens when you actually, the buying price is equal to the selling price, something like that. So this is the current means of an advertisement that gets shown. So if you see an ad next time, you should remember this cycle. Like, a lot of people have approached through the sales channel, like their sales team would have gotten 5 different advertisements. 5 different people would have quoted like, mera to itna budget hai bhai, main is rupaye se zyada kharcha nahi karunga. And then a lot of people would have done their bidding for that particular slot, and then the maximum bid got that slot, and that's how you see that ad on a real time basis. And that happens on Facebook, that happens on Instagram, that happens on all your social media as well as on your TV. And on TV, rates are as high as 2.5 lakh per second to around 3 lakh per second, roughly amounting to this, on a prime time when Sasural Simarka and stuff like that airs. So this is the kind of spending that the people do. And this is the kind of sales that happens on a real ground. So whether you want to participate in a sales activity for a ZTV, or a sales that happens for Smart Medics, whether it happens for TV, whether it happens for Topper, the basic premise always remains one thing. Selling is a hard skill, but always remember that purchasing always happens in just two ways. One is a rational purchase, and one is an irrational purchase. The irrational purchases are the ones which happen through a lot of combination with marketing. The marketing guys are expert in building a brand wherein they would play with your emotions. They would want to show you that there is much more than what you actually are thinking about it. I would sell you a Ferrero Rocher for 30 rupees. That's one small chocolate for 30 rupees, and you would still buy it because this is the power of my selling. This is the power, and I am earning a lot more money than a person who is working for Parle, because that Parle guy can't sell like me. So this is something which you should understand, that this is something happening to you throughout your purchasing cycles. And most of your purchases, I thought of it as an exercise. How many of you think that you do, which one of those purchases are more for you, for each of you? Would you do rational purchases more or irrational purchases more?
Irrational.
Almost all the time?
Yes.
Why do you think that?
Because possibly at times, things which we purchase that is not required to us, we don't have that need for that product which we'll be purchasing because it seems so interesting. And it happens.
So here, I thought of going back to my previous example. Now think of the girl. So you are the guy who went, who approached that girl with that confidence, with that, you know, I believe in myself attitude. And then just now you said that all your purchases happen, which are like mostly irrational. I don't think so. Inherently, you give something which is yours to someone, and that's a trade that has happened. Inherently, it's a trade. And most of your selling, if people admit that it's an irrational purchase, there's something which can be manipulated. There is a scope for manipulation. When things can happen without your rational brain working on it, then there is a scope for people like a good branding guy, a good sales guy, to meddle with your emotions and feelings and then sell you stuff which you don't really want. So this is essentially my last slide. Wherein it's just always about understanding what the people need, basically, and trying to sell it to them. If you reach the pinnacle of success, eventually you would be in a state wherein you would have the capability of selling them what they don't really need. But for now, start basic, work your way up, use technology efficiently, and that is the basis of every sales activity that happens. Thank you. Hey, you guys can still ask questions. So Smart Medics has this product wherein they want you to subscribe for a one-year model. And for first year, it's free. From next year, they would start charging those doctors some money for their product. They're still in a evolving phase right now. That's why they don't want to charge money initially. But yeah, like Practo, they would charge money to them. Yeah. They don't have funds, yeah. So that's the basic problem. It's there with our startup, it's there with every startup that I've known. And the only way is, so first of all, your question has to come up with some details, like in which stage of the startup journey they are in. So if they are in still their idea phase, I won't think anybody would fund them, because ideas are, you know, free. It's for everyone to have. It's the application of that idea which gets you some score. So the score is based on three things. One is if you have some cash flows coming in, if you have some bill of exchange that you have. So if you can produce that bill of exchange and you can show linearly that this was our initial sales that happened in the first month, this is the second month, this is the third month, and it's an increasing thing. You can come up with some testimonials from your customers saying that, okay, this is the kind of service that they are providing and it's phenomenal, I've used it and it's like gold. And these are the two, three things which people often have in their portfolio, and then they go to an investor and then they start pitching. So pitching necessarily has to have two basic things. One is, so investors don't necessarily pitch on what you have done on your current startup or whatever you're calling it. Rather than, they would also focus on what you are as a person. So they would try to focus what you have done in your life. What are you made of? Because your idea right now is something which can change. It can actually do a 180 degree shift eventually. Once you know, work your way and you understand what are the challenges on ground. So the idea is not much. It's always about what are your inherent strengths which you can portray, and the real practical bill of exchanges that you can portray, and you can share the increasing trend and the testimonials from the consumers. So that is the key things that you should show, plus networking. Obviously, networking helps. So Dream 11 currently does quite well because a lot of people have started playing because fantasy cricket is a cricket, football, kabaddi. So there are very few days throughout the year where there is no cricket or football or kabaddi. Like most of the days there is something or the other related to cricket. Because we follow everything. We have women's cricket, we have usual ranjis and everything, the domestic cups, plus the international cricket. So, the way cricket functions is, they have a schedule. So every tournament gives you their schedule before, let's say, 6 months or 7 months. So we manage our own calendar where we see, okay, today, what are the matches that are going on? And we know this beforehand, so we host those matches on our platform. Huh? Yeah.
So, see, for example, since you were mentioning something about, you know, the gaming, when we're talking about the gaming thing, so these days what happens is I've gone through, you know, let's say, for example, I've downloaded one game, I'm playing on that particular app. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 5 months is too much.
Too. Yeah. Getting very optimistic, you know. So 5 months, and then probably they're just not there. So say for an example, if I'm not wrong, 2 years back, people were crazy playing up Candy Crush Saga, and suddenly Candy Crush Saga has gone at loss. So what happens to those, you know, games, or what happens to those ideas?
Yeah, so games, so it's actually a very good question, because games are not the most secure and most long-lasting things, like your, you know, house which is on mortgage and which would give you returns till eternity. This is not something like that. Games have a shelf life. And once your shelf life gets over, you create another game. And you engage people on a different game. So see what people who have created Candy Crush are doing right now. They have launched three more games now, and most of those games are coming, and they are another hits. And people who created Rovio, like the people who created your Angry Birds, they have come up with newer versions and much more complicated stuff, and things that they are doing is something which is really very innovative. So in the gaming industry, it's always told that whatever you create will always have a shelf life. And that shelf life is determined by how good your game is. I see some of the people still playing Temple Run, and I really admire their, I would say, faith or whatever. So,
Thanks a lot, Harshit, for all your inputs. Thanks for sharing up all those case studies with us, specifically the medics one. Even me and Vikram, both of us would agree to that particular thing. So, thank you so much.
Thanks. As a startup in Bangalore, if you want to connect with those guys, actually, huh?
Huh? I was working with one of the company as a project manager.
Acha, that's cool.
Guys, you may proceed further for your sessions. If MMSB, guys, you are not doing anything, probably we may have an open.